Now, we're going to turn to the office of sheriff, even though you gentlemen were kind enough to take the back row. I've got more questions about your office than any other one, so could we rearrange things a little bit? I'm sorry, I started the domino effect here. Supervisor will probably be last, by the way. Okay, so these are your opening prepared statements. And I did a little drawing on my own, sort of drawing of straws, and Mark Pacci came up first, so go right ahead.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming out. My name's Mark Pacci. I'm the deputy sheriff for the sheriff's office, running for the position of sheriff. I'll start off with a little personal history. I've got 43 years of public service. Started 1975 when I joined the Marine Corps. I spent 4 years in the Marine Corps, and the tour of duty was followed by 4 years in the Air Force, where I was an aircraft mechanic, turned wrenches for a while. Went back to the Marine Corps for another 3 years, ETS out of the Marine Corps in 88, and joined the Army, and then the remainder of my 23-year military career was with the Army. Retired in 98, and shortly thereafter got on as a deputy sheriff here with Trinity County Sheriff's Office. I've been in this capacity now as a deputy sheriff for a little over 18 years, and I've worked several divisions, patrol division, jail division, narcotics division, and currently I'm in the patrol division. My platform, basically I have three major planks of my platform. There are others, but the major planks are the following. One is money. How are we going to acquire money for more deputies? Everybody wants more deputies. We need more deputies. And we'd like to have enough deputies to have 24-hour coverage and push people out into the outlying areas who very seldom see a deputy. And possibly fill resident deputy positions. That's all going to require money. How are we going to do that? Well, the status quo, what we've been trying for, like I say, the almost 20 years I've been here now, is applying for grants. That hasn't worked out too well. I've seen a precipitous decline in the manpower in the almost two decades that I've been here, utilizing that methodology. I propose something brash and different, and that is to eliminate the Trinity River Division of the California Highway Patrol and redirect that existing revenue source to the sheriff, with which he could field approximately an additional 40 deputies on top of what we have now. And to me, that makes a lot of sense. We have approximately 20 CHP officers out performing traffic function. The sheriff as well performs traffic function, but the 40 deputy, what's better, what's more efficient? 40 deputies doing all of the duties of the law enforcement, or 20 CHP officers doing traffic enforcement only? Another one is to restore the Fourth Amendment and private property rights. And in the interim, until we can get appropriate funding to field a good, healthy, robust sheriff's office, I've been amassing a posse to push some of these people out and shore up some of the deficiencies in coverage. I guess that's my time.
I should have mentioned the lady with the dinger. Yeah, that is your time. And unfortunately, we don't have a clock running, so you'll be interrupted, and appreciate you stopping when the bell goes out. Ron Hanover, you next.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Ron Hanover. I was born in Trinity County 59 years ago. I'm a fourth-generation Trinity County native. My wife, Audrey, was also raised here. Our children were born here. I've worked in our sawmills, forests, and private businesses. I love this community, and I have a lot vested in Trinity County. I've been serving Trinity County as a deputy with the Sheriff's Office for 21 years. I started my career at the Sheriff's Department working in the jail and quickly promoted to a patrol deputy. I was the lead deputy for many years and was promoted to corporal in charge of administering the code enforcement program for the past 5 years. Some of my training, 8 years United States Coast Guard, 21 years in the Sheriff's Office, 15 of those years on patrol, 14 of those years as field training officer. I trained dozens of officers that came through the Sheriff's Office. I'm trained in SWAT, SWAT sniper. I've got training in drug and endangered children investigation, active shooter emergency response training, supervisory management training, post-investigator training. I have my advanced post-certificate. Some of my plan points, building lasting partnerships with our citizenry, work with community organizations to proactively address growing concerns, address employer retention and recruitment, obtain funding for additional deputies, address the rising concerns for school safety, improve response time to calls for service, hold deputies accountable to community concerns, protect our watersheds from harmful pesticides, establish an environment of community involvement, address homelessness and related issues, help build the Sheriff's Auxiliary to be an extension of the Sheriff's Office. As your sheriff, it is my desire to be a sheriff for the people, a proactive sheriff, a sheriff that is willing to continue working in the field, a sheriff that will lead from the front lines, a sheriff that will stay in touch with the communities. And I will remain ever vigilant in staying an active part of each community. As sheriff, I will protect and defend our Second Amendment right. I will continue to work with local and state agencies to combat our county's environmental issues. Leadership is a critical part of law enforcement. With my leadership and experience and the help of the men and women of the Sheriff's Office, we will focus on the goals that I have set out to combat. I have the leadership, experience, and training needed to lead the Sheriff's Office into the future.
Kim Saxon.
Good evening. I'd also like to thank all of you for coming out tonight. We've had several candidate nights, and this is the biggest group so far, and I'm really excited about this. My name is Tim Saxon, and I want to be your next sheriff. I've got over 30 years of experience in law enforcement, starting in 1983, completing the CHP Academy in Sacramento. Went down to Los Angeles, worked as an officer in the beat down there and in the San Gabriel Valley. I promoted to sergeant, supervised field troops for several years before coming to Sacramento and working in headquarters. There I was in charge of all the department's recruitment efforts for every classification within the Highway Patrol statewide. I also did training, teaching at the academy for sexual harassment, and I did several sex discrimination investigations on employees and employees in other departments. I promoted to lieutenant, went to San Jose, went to Oakland. As a field operations officer there, I was in charge of up to 90 employees at a time, in charge of things like fleet management, auditing, overtime control. I did occupational safety and internal investigations. I was asked by a chief to go up back up to headquarters, where I went to the Office of Special Projects, which is kind of an interesting place. As you can imagine, with a department like the Highway Patrol, you have certain offices, and they all do just one thing. Well, when a certain problem presented itself, the commissioner would try and find a place to go, and if it didn't fit into the right hole, it went to special projects. So we got an opportunity to think outside the box on many issues, including facilities development and space needs assessments for dispatchers. I also did the commissioner support unit, and I was in charge of the department's grant operations, about $42, $45 million in grants per year, and preparing the annual highway safety plan for the department to give to the Office of Traffic Safety to get our grants approved. And one thing I learned there is by understanding what a grant is and what the specific components are of that grant, if you don't understand that, you're not going to get a successful grant through. And that's what my unit did. If we got denied a grant, we went back and reworked it and sent it forward again. And I was lucky enough to come up to Trinity River, where I was a commander here for almost 10 years. We moved here in 1998. My wife, my two kids, they went to the elementary school, graduated the high school, went off to college, both of them finishing off four-year degrees, moving back here and having jobs and raising their families here. So my wife has been a business owner in the community for since 2006 as well. And my hope is that you will elect me as your sheriff because I have the experience, the training, the qualifications, and the desire to be here and do the job that needs to be done to successfully protect the people of Trinity County. Thank you.
Okay, and we're going to keep these three gentlemen on the hot seat until we finish up the program for them, and then we can move out. So there are. This is getting to the questions from the audience, and again, I'm paraphrasing a lot. The generalized question would be, what specific ideas do you have that can be implemented now or shortly into your tenure with regard to school safety? And to the extent that there needs to be expanded services, what would they be and how would you fund them? Okay? So
we'll
keep the same sequence.
Barbara,
you go first.
Well, I would immediately authorize any school staff that wishes to do so to arm themselves. Quite often in the public, law enforcement is referred to as first responders. However, that's an inaccurate characterization. Typically, the second responders. The first responders are those on scene when an incident occurs. And it's incumbent upon those on scene to mitigate damage by engaging in any kind of an active shooter. That seems to be the big thing in the news lately. I would make it absolutely first thing, make that possible for those who wish to do so, and provide the training to make them efficient at that endeavor.
Thanks. Ron?
I think the first order of business is, just making contact with schools and get a good working relationship with the school employees. I know that I'm trained in active shooter response, emergency response, and I know some of the other deputies are also. And so I think that's really important to get all the deputies on board with that training. I do handle trainings in this field, and I can pass that, my knowledge on to the guys that haven't got that training. But I think the first step is just making contact with the schools, get a good working relationship.
Yeah. That's funny. I'm thinking, don't clap. Just realized I was rooting for silence.
I'm sorry, I apologize. I've used up 45 seconds already, right?
My plan? Start now.
Okay. It's a multifaceted approach to school safety. One of the things that I'm a proponent of is a school resource officer and partnered up with a juvenile counselor similar to what we had several years ago. It was a very successful program. This team went out to the various schools and they handled juvenile crisis issues. We have some serious things going on in our schools right now. We have drugs coming into the schools. We have behavioral health issues that are being addressed as well as can be by the counselors there. I'm a proponent, instead of arming the teachers, I'm looking more at continuing the active shooter training with the schools, working with the principals and superintendents, as I have already, and they've indicated a way to fund the school resource officer in the near future. I also want to continue the ALICE program that the school is doing, and I'm a proponent of the Assembly Bill 2497, the School Gun Violence Protection Fund, which will provide grants for future school resource officers and counselors within our schools.
We had several questions about, believe it or not, cannabis. Particularly for the sheriff's office, whether or not a person's association with the youth use or cultivation or in any other way association with cannabis would affect your policies with regard to concealed weapons permits. Ron, do you want to take that one on?
You know, I've actually been giving that some thought, and I haven't really come up with, you know, how I want to approach that issue as far as the cannabis growers being armed. I know that's not a current policy we have in the sheriff's office at this time, and that's something that I will look at in the future and address that at an appropriate time.
Okay. Tim?
I'm not totally sure on the question that's being asked. It's whether or not you use or cultivate the cannabis, you can get a CCW. My understanding right now is if you are addicted to any type of narcotics or any Schedule I substances, then you are precluded from getting a CCW in California. And I was just talking to somebody about this the other day, and apparently there is some type of a rule change in the state of California. I'm not familiar with all of it yet, so I told this individual that, you know, right now, you would not be able to get a CCW under my administration unless I can see that those changes have been made in the government code and penal code. So that's where I stand on that right now. I'm going to follow the law. If the law says you can get it, then you come in, you talk to me, we'll have an interview, and if I deem it necessary, then yes, you will go ahead and get it.
Okay, Mark?
I'm a proponent of constitutional carry. It's the only option. It's dictated by the Constitution. I've sworn allegiance to that Constitution, which is the supreme law of the land. And therefore, no, I would not. We can't pick and choose who can exercise the rights and who can't. The supreme law of the land says you have that right, and I will enforce it.
There are a number of questions interested in better coverage, including resident deputies. I know that this lapses back into funding questions, but if you have any particular ideas about how to have more coverage, particularly in the more isolated parts of the county, let's see. Who started last time? Mark did. Tim, you take
right.
No.
That's thank you. Okay, the number one issue here is going to involve funding. We need additional resources to get additional deputies to get them out on the road. No doubt about it, there's no escaping from it. My key point here is my administration will be looking for as many funding sources as possible. Looking outside the box again, like I talked about before, get as many deputies as we can and get them into the outlying communities. But also related to that is building coalitions and talking to allied agencies. We have CHP officers, we have Forest Service, we have Fish and Wildlife. They're law enforcement just like we are. My contention on this is that until such time as we can get additional resources out there from the Sheriff's Department, we need to enlist the help of every allied agency out there to respond. Maybe just stand by until we can get an officer there. But honestly, folks, if you call in for an emergency call, you don't really care what color uniform it is. And all you care about is it's a badge and a gun that shows up and protects you. And that's what I'm looking forward to.
I believe that philosophy is part of the problem. You know, since I've been at the Sheriff's Office, we've seen a precipitous decline in the number of deputies and a precipitous incline in the number of California Highway Patrol officers. So I don't see that that's an answer. It's true, people want to see a cop when they show up, but what it's led to is the number of deputy sheriffs going down, the number of CHP officers and other agencies going up. I don't see that as a benefit to the Sheriff's Office or our constituents. What was that? That's okay. What was the beginning?
You're on coverage, Tracy.
Oh. In the interim, until money comes available to make that come to fruition, I've been amassing a posse, and last count is over 400 strong, and I intend to push those people out into the areas where we don't have coverage to shore up the deficiencies on the deputies that are waiting to come.
Okay, well, I've been working on this issue already. I've spoken to the deputies that are on patrol and have asked them to to spend more time in some of the outlying areas. Once I become sheriff, then we're going to work on scheduling to schedule people in certain areas instead of just having all of them scheduled in two places. Right now, we have more deputies than we have. I mean, we've been down to 5 deputies at times. Right now, I think we're at 9 or 10. That's not too bad. You know, we can do it a lot with 10. It's really, really hard to get much more than that. Yeah, I've been here for 21 years, and we have 10, 11, then we're down to 5. It's a battle that we continually have, and, you know, we just got to work on
getting
more.
A lot of questions on the extent to which you have administrative experience and supervisory experience and what ideas you have with regard to administration and supervision that might differ from best practices. I think I'm back to starting with Mark, please.
I have done with the sheriff's office. However, I have in a 23-year military career, I've led combat troops, large numbers of combat troops, so I know how to lead people up. I don't know what else to say other than that. I have no experience at the sheriff's office meeting, and I've done a good portion of that by choice. I prefer to be the guy in charge to make decisions for the entire department instead of just being a middleman and doling out what the top dog, what comes down from the sheriff.
Okay, I'm going to jump over to Tim on this one now. Let Ron do less.
Throughout my career, I've chosen to take a different path. I chose the path of supervision, administration, and management. And I did that because personally, prior to coming into law enforcement, I was involved in management with a retail store, and I also managed an armed car company. So talking about deployments, talking about personnel, talking about employee unions, rights, and things of that nature, I've done that my entire career. Promoting to sergeant, field supervisor, I had an active role in what was going on in deployments in the streets. Going up to lieutenant, I increased my administrative skills to look at statewide programs, huge operations. As a captain in Gilroy, I have 55 employees that I manage. From a janitor all the way up to sergeant, and I was in charge of the traffic operations in San Bernardino County and the southern part of Santa Clara County, working hand-in-hand with various police departments and sheriff's departments. I feel that my experience in this manner qualifies me uniquely for sheriff.
Ron's going to be next, but just a warning, gentlemen, your 3 minute free time is coming up right away, too, because I wanted to finish up one office and move on to the next office. So, Ron, you're responding now to that question about administration and supervision.
Okay, so, how's that? Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Working in the sheriff's office for the last 21 years, you know, pretty much everything we do is managing. We manage search warrants, we manage natural disasters. That's just part of what we do. You know, I've been a lead deputy in Hayfork for many years. I'm managing the code enforcement program right now. And what I want to do as a sheriff is I want to be a leader to our team, and what the sheriff's office is a team, and I want to be a leader to that team by being proactive with what my crew is doing. You know, they're serving search warrants, they're doing this, they're doing that. I know I got administrative duties that I have to do.
Okay, now. Free time, new subjects, address things that the other candidates have said, get the high points that you want to repeat, anything fair being here in these 3 minutes, and we're going to start with you, Tom.
Well,
Folks, you're presented with three very qualified people here. I will say that because all three of us up here have devoted our lives to law enforcement. Again, I chose a different path. All three of us went to the same post academies, a peace officer standardized training. So we started off on the same footing. You know, I've gone past that as I talked about working as an officer, sergeant, lieutenant, captain. So I have patrol and administrative experience at every one of those ranks. I've actually performed the duties similar to a sheriff as a commander in two different field commands. And what's really important to remember is there's a steep learning curve to becoming sheriff. There's a lot of administrative things that need to be learned. There's a lot of management things that need to be learned. There's a lot of relationships that have to be made with employee unions, with department heads, with allied agencies at the state and federal level. I've done that. I've experienced it. I've been trained in it. I've also been trained in teaching sexual harassment, racial profiling, hate crimes. And why that's important is because in Trinity County, we have a very diverse population. And I think what's important to understand on that is that the people that are serving you, doing your public service day in and day out, they need to know that they are doing things the right way so that everyone is treated fairly and equitably. Now's the time for new approaches and innovative ideas to solving our problems that we have here. I've been working with Health and Human Services, Behavioral Health, the schools, with probation, the courts. We have a program called Treatment Court Program. I've been on the Opioid Safety Council. I'm doing everything I can to understand the problems that we have in our county. Those counties, those problems, I feel confident that I can address and I can solve with a little bit of time. It's not going to happen overnight. It may take a year, 2 years, maybe it may take 5 years, 10 years. But the whole thing is while I'm actively out there protecting the public, I'm also going to be working internally in the department, ensuring that everyone in there has enough training capabilities, enough training opportunities, so that they can be as qualified and move up in the promotional ranks as fast as they want or as slow as they want. Succession planning, to me, is a very important part of any business. And that's what we have here. The Sheriff's Department is a business. You're electing a CEO, and that CEO is going to go out there and provide services to you, the customer. It's plain and simple as that. I have the training, I have the experience, I have the knowledge, and I have the desire to do this and be your sheriff and really do my role in protecting your colleague.
My opponents said we're going to take a new path, and what I'm hearing, it's the same path that I've seen in the past 20 years, and through several administrations and even more elections. I keep hearing the same thing over and over and over again. It doesn't work, and it hasn't worked, and you know what they say about attempting to repeat the same behavior over and over and over again, expect the same, a different outcome. I present a different way forward. I present a different way forward that's much different than the other two candidates running for sheriff. And if you want to, the status quo, same old, try the same stuff, you can reinvent the wheel, those are your options, or you can try a different path forward. And I put myself out there in that regard to give you that option.
I just have a few words here. You know, I have a promise, and that promise is I'll be a proactive sheriff for the people, I'll be a proactive sheriff with department heads, and with the sheriff's office. I'll always strive to make Trinity County a better, safer place to live, visit, and to raise our families. I will always be honest and sincere. I will always do my best to serve and protect our citizens. You are the people who elect me as your sheriff, and as sheriff, I will do what the people would have me do. What it comes down to is, what do you really want? It is to feel safe in your home and in the community. I have 21 years of it investigating thousands of crimes and learning the politics for each of the communities. With my training and experience and the knowledge of what the communities need and want, I'm well trained to be your sheriff. Thank you.